So let me welcome everyone. Our guest today is Filip Hauke, who is a professor at the University of Trento. Let me say a few words about Filip. So he did his PhD with Professor Levenstein at ICFO in 2013. And this is where I got to know Filip. Then he was a postdoctoral researcher with Professor Zoller in Innsbruck for more or less 5 years. Since 2019, he's a professor at the University of Trento, where he has his own group. Filip's scientific interests are very broad and cover such areas as quantum simulators, quantum computing, quantum entanglement, and also quantum metrology, as I noticed recently. And let me also add that Filip was awarded an ERC starting grant in 2018. So I would say he's very successful in his career. Today, Filip will tell us about quantum simulators. Filip, the microphone is yours.
Yeah, thanks a lot. Thanks, Remek, for the nice introduction, and thanks for the invitation here. It's really a pleasure and an honor to speak here. So I will see if I can share the presentation. Okay. So now you should see the slides in full screen, I hope. Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, exactly. So as Remek said, I want to talk about quantum simulation, and in particular about quantum simulation of lattice gauge theories. So I'm going to show you the work that we are doing, but I also try to put it into a broader context of what the field is doing, how the field is moving forward. And so so I chose here the title, the subtitle, High Energy Physics at Ultra Cold Temperatures. So usually when we think about high energy physics, maybe you think about these large scale facilities such as at CERN. So this is the LS detector at CERN, and there the experimentalists, they smash heavy ions into each other, and then out of the fragments they try to reconstruct what has happened during the collision event. But it's not only a large scale experimental effort, it's also a large scale theory effort. So in fact, they're trying to compute the dynamics or also phase diagram of elementary particles. That is one of the main drivers of scientific high performance computing. So what we want to do is we want to bring a third player into the game, namely the quantum computer, which can be either universal quantum computers or analog quantum devices, to try and solve some of the questions from high energy physics. And or nuclear physics also. But let me just a disclaimer up front. So of course, this is not going to supplant in any way the scientific experiments. And it's also not going to supplant the classical computers, at least not for quite some time to come. So the hope instead is that the quantum computer can solve specific problems that are, for example, very, very hard to solve for the classical computer, such as out of equilibrium dynamics of many body systems. And so to get additional insights. So this development is actually, it's quite an exciting development right now. We're still very far away from solving things like this heavy ion collision, which would be quantum chromodynamics in four space-time dimensions. But there's quite some progress in recent years. To give a very brief overview, so this quantum simulation of gauge theories, this started about 10 years ago. There were a few theory groups. Maciek Levenstein was on the forefront of this. And also others, Peter Zoller, Ignacio Sack, and so on. But now there are many, many theory groups, and I'm for sure have forgotten many also, so I apologize for anyone who's forgotten here. So this was about 2010, and then a few years later, this theory effort then led to the first experiment, which was done in a digital quantum computer in Innsbruck. And since then, there's now lots of experiments that have come up in different platforms, and superconducting qubits, photons, also recently several in neutral atoms. So it's really an accelerating development. If you're interested, I also invite you to look at these reviews. I will show them up again at the end of the talk, which give an overview of all the development that is happening in the field. But actually, so why we do this? I mean, one question is, yes, we are interested in the science of the of high energy physics. We want to understand some many body dynamics, etc. But actually, we are also, if you put this into a broader context, we are also interested in pushing forward to a universal quantum computer, which we do not have right now. Right, so the, we don't have really universal machines that are fully scalable and fully error corrected and so on. If we had these, then we could just compute anything that we want in quantum many body systems. But okay, we don't have these, so we have to think what can we do with these quantum devices now that is reasonable. And here I think that exactly pursuing these gauge theories is a very relevant target for several reasons. So they host very fascinating physics, they are very challenging for implementations, and this also makes them interesting because they are a good test bed to try error mitigation strategies, implementation strategies, and so on. And in very specific scenarios of quantum many-body dynamics, we may be very close to a quantum advantage. And then, of course, the question is, how can you prove it, et cetera. So it's a very difficult question, but maybe you're not far away. It's at least the number of qubits I'm going to show is getting in a regime where it's becoming very, very interesting. Yeah, and also if you look at these gauge theories, they have also very close connections to topological systems, topological quantum memories, et cetera. So also in this, it's very relevant to look at them now because they can also open new ways for these computing paradigms. Okay. So, but if you want, if you now focus again on gauge theories, so what we need to do, I want to show you a sort of a little bit of a roadmap, what we want to achieve to do something relevant with a quantum simulation of gauge theories. And so the first step that I think, if we push in this direction, that we need to do is, if we cannot yet tackle quantum chromodynamics in four space-time dimensions, so does it mean that we need to wait 20 years more? This would be a little bit boring for the field. So the question is, so we should first identify relevant phenomena that you can access right now with the machines that exist in the lab. Then we also want to proceed to get the more complex systems and larger systems. So we need to really have scalable implementations. And once we scale up, we also need to ensure that these devices work. And these are various questions that are interesting also from a theory side to pursue. And yeah, so these are also sort of the outline of my talk. So I'm going to address these three topics as examples of recent work, but I'm going to proceed this with the target model that we are studying, which is quantum electrodynamics. And then there will be some conclusions in the end. Okay. Good, so let's start with the target model. Yeah, so what we're looking at here are gauge theories, because we're ultimately interested in understanding something about elementary particles. And these are what the main theory for this is the standard model of particle physics, and this is governed by gauge theories. So if you have, for example, we have quarks and gluons, these are described by an SU3 gauge theory, which is quantum chromodynamics, but as I said, it's very challenging. So let's see if we have something simpler. And well, indeed, we have the interplay of charges with the electric magnetic field. That is just a U1 gauge theory, which makes things much simpler to for the beginning to test implementation strategies, etc. So here, in this talk, I'm actually going to focus only on quantum electrodynamics. But I'm going to show you that it's actually a very interesting test bed. So here, this is the target Hamiltonian. We're actually going to be even simpler. We are just going to one spatial dimension. Yeah? But again, so it's interesting enough this morning. Yeah? Okay, so here this is the Hamiltonian. We have walked you through it, so just so that we have the same language and are on the same page. So it has several parts here, fermionic spinors, which describe electrons and positrons, and they are, so this term here just describes the resonance. It just counts how many electrons and positrons we have, and then okay, they cost the resonance. But now this should be particles that can move, so they have a kinetic energy described by this derivative here. But it should not only be particles, it should be charged particles. Okay? So from the positive to the negative charge, we also have an electric field. the electric field has its own energy. But now there's one very important thing, namely that so these should be really charges. So if an electron moves, then the electric field should just not stand around, but it should adapt immediately to this new charge configuration. So we need to couple the dynamic, the kinetic energy of the electrons in the field, and this we achieve via the vector potential here in minimal coupling. Okay, so these are the ingredients for the theory, and we want these couple degrees of freedom because they give us a very interesting phenomena, as I'm going to show you in a second. But this is not all. So now it's not sufficient to just have a quantum computer with different degrees of freedom, whereas then maybe one does some interesting many-body dynamics, but it's not a gauge theory. So here what we want this local gauge symmetry. And in this case, it's nothing else than the Gauss's law. So the divergence of the electric field minus the charge density, this should be zero always. So if I take this generator and act with it on the quantum state, then for any position at any time, this should always give a zero. And this is a conserved quantity that is local. So this is something that I want to fulfill. And this is actually the hard part. Just pictorially, what does it mean? Well, it means that the positive charge is a source of field lines, a negative charge is a sink of field lines. And then you cannot have situations like this. So the field line ends somewhere in the vacuum, so this is not allowed. Okay, so now we need to make sure that our quantum simulator has only certain configurations fulfilled and other configurations are excluded. Okay, and this we need, because otherwise we are doing something, but maybe not a gauge theory. Okay, so this is our target model. Now you may say, well, it looks very simple. It's just 1D and U1 and so on. This is actually an interesting model. So I first want to show you that indeed it is an interesting model. So there are many interesting phenomena that one can tackle. One is the so-called Schwinger mechanism, which goes actually back to as early as the 50s, where Julian Schwinger wrote down an analytic solution for the following problem. So imagine you have a very strong background electric field. So for example, you can think of it as being generated by some capacitor that is outside of the system. And now what happens is, well, the vacuum is not really the vacuum, so the vacuum fluctuations, electrons and positrons. And now due to this very strong field, these vacuum fluctuations are, so to say, ripped apart, and the particles, they are accelerated. Okay, and so now what happens if you have a region with a very strong field, so you apply a very, very strong electric field and then real particles fly out of this field. So you convert electric field into particles, which I find is quite an intriguing phenomenon. So some years ago, we tried to see if this could be seen in a quantum simulator, and this is a calculation that we did using a path integral method. So here this dot dashed line, this is the analytic prediction due to Schwinger for the rate of particle production, so the number of particles per unit time that come out. And then this is not yet unfortunately experimental data. This is a simulation of a quantum simulation experiment. Okay, what we think that the simulator achieves right now under realistic conditions. And yeah, so okay, so I think it looks quite reasonable enough to reproduce this curve. There's one feature that I want to highlight in this curve, namely there's actually a non-perturbative onset here. So there's this EC that's a critical field. It's not critical in the sense of a phase transition, but it's critical in the sense that here is a non-perturbative thing happening. And so this would be very interesting to actually see this transition. This critical behavior. There are these large-scale laser facilities that try to generate very strong fields to be above the critical field and then to see this particle generation. But as far as I know, it has not yet been achieved. Well, here in the quantum simulator, this is just a parameter that one can tune. So one can just tune to go above the critical field. It's very easy. So that's the nice thing about the quantum simulators. This has been actually realized, but just for a single building block. And then, of course, in a single building block, you cannot really talk about particles that come out of the system or so. I'm going to talk a little bit about this.
May I inject a remark at this point?
Yes.
Yes, sure. There are also classical computations of the 1D QED effects, like the one that you are showing. And one of these main authors of these things is Rainer Grobe. Are you familiar with these papers? They are about 15 years old.
Maybe not in detail, I guess. So what did they compute or show?
Well, they compute a lot of these basic QED processes in 1D QED models. So absolutely numerically. Mm-hmm.
So what I can say, so I'm not sure about this work, but in general, it's also here with also lots of numerics. There are very powerful methods that work at weak coupling. So when E over M is small.
I'm talking about very strong field effects. Something which is called Klein paradox, I remember very well from their papers. And that is also requiring, you know, a very strong gradient of the outside field, which is also producing pairs.
Yeah, exactly. So that's a very, very good and very important remark. Yeah? So this is, for example, also these techniques, they work at weak coupling, but it's not perturbative. So it's because the field is very, very strong. Yeah. So this is, there exist, for example, what we used here. I mean, this is the expertise of Jürgen Berges and his group that did these calculations. These are path integral methods that you can use in a non-perturbative regime when essentially the field strength times the coupling constant is still a large number, so it's completely non-perturbative. But E over M itself is a small number. And in this sense, it's weak coupling, but completely not non-perturbative. I'm not sure if these are similar techniques.
This is just a straightforward simulation on the classical computers done on a grid. The biggest problem numerically there that they have some way of solving, I do not remember exactly what, is the presence of these incredibly high frequencies which are due to the rest energy of the electron and positron. Mm-hmm. But they are somehow getting rid of those, so they have, so to say, slowly varying quantities only. But then otherwise than that, there is no assumption of weak coupling or anything like that. Mm-hmm.
So these are really, in the sense, numerical. So,
absolutely, yes.
Okay. I'm going to mention this also during the talk. That, I mean, there are very powerful tensor network techniques, of course, for example. Here we're talking about 1D. So there you can go very, very far with tensor networks.
Yeah.
So of course this means that if we do just the quantum simulation in 1D, then we have a very hard time to compete with the existing numerical techniques. But on the other hand, it's a very good benchmark case, because then we can compare the quantum simulator with the numerical simulation. But I believe that these numerics, if you go to higher dimensions, then they will.
Then it's hopeless.
These are very, very important remarks to put all this into context. I mean, yeah, this is why I said this. I mean, this quantum advantage here, we went somewhere there, but maybe we can hope in the near future to get something, but also maybe not, yeah, because the numerics is also getting better very fast. And of course, the problems in the quantum simulator, it's an open system. So. Hmm? Also this remark shows, in any case, there are groups working on these questions to try to understand the dynamics of the systems also by tackling these numerics. So these are interesting phenomena. This phenomenon here is completely out of equilibrium. There are also interesting phenomena in equilibrium. There's something that's called the Coleman phase transition here. It's called a topological theta angle of pi. This QED has some topological vacuum structure, etc. But it's actually, here for our purpose, you can just understand this as a fancy name for saying it's a background field. So what would this mean? Well, so if you feed in a half quantum of a background field in the system, so then what can happen if you have a very small mass or a negative mass? So you would like to have many electrons and positrons in the system. So the system would be completely full of charges, and they will just overscreen this background field back and forth. And so if you take the average, there's no field in the system, completely screened out in the average. But now if you increase the rest mass, what will happen is that these charges, they will annihilate each other. And then the background field just passes unhindered through the system. But now, for example, nothing says that this electron has to annihilate this positron. It can also annihilate this positron here. And then you can get the situation where you have boundary charges left. So now this field that comes in is overscreened. And actually, there's a field line that passes through the system in the opposite direction. Now in the thermodynamic limit, these two situations, they come completely degenerate. So actually what we have here is a spontaneous symmetry breaking between this zero field, this green situation, and this situation where the system passes through. And there's a critical point in between. And one can do calculations. For example, this is tensor network calculations. And indeed, I mean, they have large systems of 140 sites already several years ago. Okay, so we first need quantum computers that have so many degrees of freedom. The computer data. But anyway, so they compute here this the critical point and see there's a region which is screened and which is unscreened. Okay, so this is also quite an interesting phenomenon that we see here. Also, one thing that I also should mention maybe is that here in 1D is also special in many cases because in many ways because there's also not a really a propagating free photon, so that's not a propagating electromagnetic wave, but still we have because there's no magnetic field, for example. But you still have an electric field, so you see there's still many interesting phenomena even in 1D. Okay, so but these are phenomena that are known already in the community, I mean, from the 50s or 70s. But actually, what I find very fascinating about this cross-disciplinary program is that different communities come together. No? There are people from high-energy physics, from nuclear physics, people from quantum optics, from quantum information, condensed matter, and so on. And so there are new ways of thinking about this model and these problems. And so there are actually new phenomena also coming up. So we had several sort of new phenomena that I find quite interesting. So one thing, just give you little bit of an advertisement, I don't want to dwell too much on them. But one thing that we saw in a recent work is that if we quench this topological tethering, so this spectrum field essentially, just change it very rapidly and then look at the out of equilibrium dynamics afterwards. If you study the Loschmidt echo, for example, we see that there are kinks, so there's these dynamical quantum phase transitions. And if you look at this correlator, which is it's a Fermion correlator at 2 points, and we take the Fourier transform, we can plot the time evolution of this thing, it's time against momentum, and we look at the phase of this. We see that each momenta, this Fermion correlator rotates. So this goes from zero over 2 pi, that's rotations, which is given by the band gap essentially. But then there are here there are vortices which appear at critical times. And so there's some sort of dynamical topological transition that one could call, and one can relate this to an out of equilibrium Fermi surface and so on. Okay, so this is by looking at the system through this new lens of dynamical quantum phase transitions. We also did another investigation, so we thought about what happens if you don't fulfill Gauss's law exactly, but you have a small error in the experiment, some thing that breaks gauge invariance with a small strength lambda. And we just looked at the dynamics. And for example, here we plot the gauge violation. So how much do we deviate from, so from G should always equal to zero, right? So this is the Gauss law generator. So if the square of this is non-zero, then we are violating somewhere. Okay, and so if you look at the time evolution, this is a log scale here. So you see that there's an initial increase. And then suddenly, so to say, by itself, the system slows down and there's no violation for a very long time. So there's a long plateau that goes over orders of magnitude in time. And then again, it goes up and then there's another plateau and then it goes up again. So there's a sort of a pre-thermalization effect, which is we call it staircase pre-stabilization because it was in several steps. Okay, so here this is exact numerics. One thing that we don't know is if this effect persists in the thermodynamic limit. We see it for finite systems as far as we can go. It would be interesting to see if it persists. But anyway, so this is also an effect that in if one thinks about QED from a subatomic physics perspective, this doesn't make any sense to even ask this question because we say Gauss law is a natural law. But here in the quantum simulator, it makes sense to think about these questions. And so there are also other groups, of course, working on this, this collaboration of Trieste and Dresden, where they also do a quench in this model from a special initial state, and then use log of time. So they see that there is a very slow increase of the von Neumann entropy, which is a hallmark of many body localization. So they see this model by itself doesn't have disorder, but due to the gauge invariance, you see it behaves as a disordered system with many body localization. So this is, in some sense, this is a model that is already decades old, but there's still new surprises. I hope that you're convinced that this is an interesting model to look at, but now we actually want to implement it in a quantum simulator, right? So this is what you set out. So I want to now discuss a little bit about how we can go to scalable implementations. By the way, if you have questions or remarks or anything, then it's good if you will just interrupt me. And if I don't manage to go through all the material, it's also fine. I'm happy about comments and questions. But maybe I continue.
No questions at the moment.
Exactly. But just keep it in mind. So if you have one, just. Okay. So we want to do implementation. So right now in this field, there are two main approaches, I would say. One is that one actually uses the Gauss's law to get rid of one of these 2 degrees of freedom because they're intrinsically connected. And another approach is to really try to keep all the degrees of freedom, the electric charges and the electric field, and then use some tricks to reduce the dynamics to only the gauge invariant configurations. And well, in the beginning, I showed all these experiments. Many experiments actually going along this line here, where they use the Gauss law, but many that are in neutral atoms mostly, they use both degrees of freedom. And I want to give you an idea of how these work by talking about this experiment, which is a little bit older now, and these two here. And I've chosen these, of course, because I was involved in them, so it's easier to talk about them. Let's start with this one here. So this was actually also the first implementation of a gauge theory in a quantum computer. So this was back in 2016, and so it worked in the following way. So here is again our Hamiltonian, okay? And now we have Gauss's law. So we have the derivative of E is equal to charge density. Now we can formally integrate this, okay? So E is now expressed as an integral over the charge density. We can plug it in here. Yeah? So we get rid of the E here, which then means on the remaining Hamiltonian, we can do a unitary transformation on the fermions in this way. And together, what they do is this part has replaced the E square. So now we have here rho. Okay? And this part has removed the vector potential in this new, we can maybe call it addressed fermions. Okay? So now we have this modified model, which now is where the electric field doesn't appear any more explicitly. So it's just we can reconstruct it by looking at the fermions and then reconstructing what is the field configurations, but they are tied to each other. And this is also quite special about 1D, that we can use this trick in this form. So now what we have is the trapped ion quantum computer here. This is this false color plot of the photoluminescence of the ions. Okay, so we have discrete ions on a string. Each of these has two internal states, 0 or 1, or up and down and then spin on half. And now we want to map this model to the qubits. So the first thing is, this is a discrete space, so we need to somehow to discretize this continuum theory, but luckily there are, in the numerics for gauge theories, there are known techniques for decaying, so we can just copy them. There are a few subtleties that one has to be aware of, but then we can just copy these techniques, and that's fine. So very roughly speaking, we now have the degrees of freedom discretized onto some lattice spacing. Yeah? Not a,
one question. In this approach, you assume that there is no external electric field. The only electric field is present due to the presence of fermions. It's produced by fermions of the system, right?
That's right, yeah.
Then only this transformation is valid.
Mm-hmm. That's true, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah, that's important, yeah. Okay, so we have discretized the system. And the second thing is that we need to take care of that. Here we're talking about fermions, but we want them to have on qubits or spins. But also there, of course, we can use the Jordan-Wigner transformation because we're talking about 1D. 2D becomes much more complicated, but here we are lucky. So we just replace the annihilation operator by a sigma minus plus the Jordan-Wigner string and the number operator by a sigma z. So essentially, if there's a fermion there, this corresponds to a spin up. If there's no fermion, it corresponds to a spin down. Okay, so we plug these things in, and then out of this system, out of this model that describes quantum electrodynamics, we got this pure spin model here. So this first term, this is the kinetic energy. So if a fermion moves, then the spin goes down and the next spin goes up. It moves by one lattice side. The rest mass goes into the field if you want to have the fermion there or not, biased by a sigma z field. And now the tricky part is the electric field here. So this gives us some linear terms, which you just put here that you don't care about, but then they give also, if you square them out, some sigma z interaction. Now this interaction matrix, because of the long-range nature of the Coulomb interactions, but it's really a long-range interaction where everyone interacts with everyone, but in 1D, there's this linear dependence of the interaction. So it's not very natural for the trapped ions. In trapped ions, one can get maybe a constant interaction or something that just decreases with distance, but not this linear behavior. So it's not natural, but if you have a universal quantum computer, we can just apply gates between the ions that we want. No? And so what we did is we derived an algorithm, a trotterized algorithm for this Hamiltonian here. So here these are the four timelines of the four qubits that were used in the experiment. We have the gates, XX and YY gates, which do the kinetic energy. Okay. Then you have the Coulomb interaction, so sigma z gates. So these are all done by Molmer-Sorensen gates rotating in different bases. And then the rest mass, which is just single qubit rotation. So this actually, in the end, if you write it like this, it looks quite straightforward. Just want to say that what allowed to do the experiment at this stage was that really we used this trick of integrating out so that with four qubits, they could do it. Look at four meta sites plus the electric fields. So the first attempt was to have only three qubits, but then it would have been just one meta field, the fermion and the positron, essentially the tunnel, and then the field flips back and forth. So it's actually just the two-level system, which is a little bit very small. But due to the integrating out, we could have four qubits with four meta sites, starting to become a many-body system. And the second thing that we achieved here is that these interactions, they are all to all. So one would assume that you need n square, a number of gates of n square to do this. But actually, not all of them are independent. So we were able to reduce it to n. So n applications of the Molmer-Sorensen gate. And that's really nice because that reduced the complexity. That's just a polynomial improvement of complexity, but for the current devices, this makes it from just not possible to just possible. Yeah, so, so then we repeat this process step. Now let's look at one experimental result. They looked at several things, but for example, they studied the particle density. So let's see what happens. Huh? Okay, so the initial state is just the bare vacuum. So you can think of this as the state as rest mass to infinity, and then the Hamiltonian is turned on a different rest mass and hopping strength. And then one sees, well, there are particles that are being produced. Some quench dynamics that's going on. So here also we see that that we have quite well under control what's happening in the experiment. So these three lines are theory. The solid line would be the continuous time result. The triangle is the trotterized simulation, which is quite close, and we understand that this is in a controlled regime, etc. And these squares, there are simulation, numerical simulation taking salient experimental errors into account. And you see they are very close to the real experimental data. So we understand very well what the experiment does. Well, okay, the group of random blood, they understand very well what the machine does. this was very nice. This experiment was actually called a breakthrough of the year in the physics world. I think it was quite amazing because at this moment in time, it was really the largest quantum simulation or even quantum computation that had ever been done. And so one small anecdote, we theorists wanted to push them a little bit further that they make a slightly larger system or go to longer times, but they could not do this because there was some part of the electronics that had to save the gate sequence and then to control the quantum computer. And this electronics, they couldn't take a longer gate sequence because before they had never needed a longer gate sequence. Okay, and suddenly here they were at the limit. So that's very curious. There was a classical electronics which was limiting their quantum computer. I mean, now of course they have.
I have a question. What makes the vacuum move? Because the vacuum just is the ground state, and it will remain forever.
I mentioned this, but I think it was not very clear. So the vacuum is, this is a quench experiment. So we start from the vacuum actually at the infinite mass. So this is just, it's a simple separable state. And then we turn on the Hamiltonian at the finite value of the mass.
So it's not the real vacuum.
It's not the real vacuum at the physical value of the mass. Yeah. Exactly. So here it's really, it's the vacuum at infinite rest mass, if you want. So that's why I call it the bare vacuum. I don't know how to call this the state. It's the infinite rest mass state. So, yeah.
May I also ask a question?
Mm-hmm. Please.
actually, you discretized your system, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So there is the lattice spacing somewhere, a dimensionful parameter.
Mm-hmm.
I believe that if you consider a dimensionful quantity, psi bar or psi dagger psi is a dimensionful quantity, you should see the influence of this scale introduced by lattice spacing in your results. I am asking because this is the main problem of conventional lattice gauge theory, of precise control of the influence of the lattice cutoff on your final results.
Mm-hmm. That is also a very important remark. Because the system is very small, so just four lattice sites, there's no hope of trying to do a scaling with the lattice spacing. Here we just took it as a parameter and then let this parameter fix. We have, for example, in this where we tried to extrapolate the rate for the Schwinger model that I showed before. I don't want to go back because one is letting me. This analytic rate that I showed for the Schwinger model, There, for example, we assume that if you have something like 40 lattice sites or so, then you can try an extrapolation of this lattice space. So it's not okay. Maybe you can go back to the. Okay, so this is also so these results here, for example, they also take this finite lattice spacing into account, but also trying to see if you can extrapolate. And so this is one reason why we have this error bar here. So we it seems you can get close to the result, but of course you see that, that it gives some uncertainty. And so for a quantum simulation, that is exactly the same problem as for classical numerics in lattice gate theories. Does it answer the question?
I understand, but the problem is not only to extrapolate to zero, so to speak, with the lattice spacing, mm-hmm. and to go to continuous limit, but in quantum field theory, you inevitably, your cutoff appears in the final result. So if you have a dimensional quantity of dimension of mass, it necessarily will come out of your calculation proportional to the inverse of the cutoff. And to separate this component from the real dynamics, when I last looked at it about 10 years ago, it was actually impossible. So lattice can be used to estimate dimensionless ratios or averages of parameters, which have so-called twist two. So therefore their expectation value can be reduced to a dimensionless number. Mm-hmm. Because for dimensionful parameters, you always get, this is dimensional transmutation, if you would like, right? Always receive a contribution from states around the cutoff. Mm-hmm. And that's going to be proportional to the cutoff in appropriate power, right?
As you said, the dimensionless quantities that are cut off independent, right? So you can.
Sure, of course.
So that's. So in this sense, so maybe this quantity that I showed you, I don't know, I understand your remark correctly. The quantity that I showed you in this sense may not be the best if you really want to talk about continuum physics and see if you can really get QED.
That was my question basically, right?
Okay, this is, I agree, but this is a very small system, so I also don't want to dwell too much actually on the physics of what we have seen here. There's all these questions also. It's a quench experiment that starts from infinite mass, so does it actually make sense? Then also the cutoff dependence. This is more to illustrate that. So now we have these possibilities to start looking at these quantum simulations. I'm going to show you also new results where we have much larger systems, and then we can try to start really talk about relevant physics. This is one thing that we need to identify, also what are cutoff independent quantities that we can extract from the simulation. Okay, but thanks for the remark.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
It was a breakthrough of the year, but also again, we need actually to be very modest. Now we have these discussions. It was just 4 qubits, and it was 200 gates. Yeah, that's really nice. But now also in this universal digital approach, just to say what is the state of art now, there's very recently a work by Google where they look at the Fermi-Hubbard model, so not the gauge theory, and there they now have 16 qubits and more than 600 gates in one sequence. So it's also the improvement in just a couple of years, just 4 years, is actually also quite exciting. So I think we need to be modest with saying what we have achieved right now, but it's also, there is a trajectory forward, no? There's a fast development. Also, if you look at, so in this context of gauge theories, there are, so now there are much larger systems available now. So there's this, the Blood group has done now computations with 20 ions where they look at ground state physics and they see Coleman's phase transition. In the looping group, they have even 51 qubits where they also look at Coleman's phase transition and French dynamics. Okay? So this is now the state of art in this context where one uses the gauge field to actually allow only physical configurations to use, so use this Gauss law. Just also want to point out, so what I showed you, this was the first experiment in this direction. It may seem that now it's very special and it will not work if you look at other models, but actually there are people working on general framework of, in this direction. So just cite here two papers, but there are also there are many more. And they show that you can get also tackle non-abelian theories in this way, you can do higher dimensions, and you can do it in a way that you don't have long range interactions, but that everything is local in the end. Okay? So maybe the interactions are complicated, but they are local interactions. So, so this can be expanded. Okay. I also wanted to talk about this second approach where both degrees of freedom are actually kept. So this is done, I think, almost exclusively in cold atoms and optical lattices. So just as a reminder, we have this periodic lattice structure of the atoms, and they sit at the lattice minima. They're described as some annihilation operator, and now they can tunnel from one lattice site to the next, described by a tunneling strength J. Okay, so there's a tunneling term, and we have some interaction term, so we have some quartic term. Okay, and this is essentially what we have, and now we can make it more and more complicated by taking different internal states, making lattice sites of different depth, and even put fermions and bosons together into one lattice. But in the end, it will be just tunnelings and quartic interactions. Now, this is to say the resource that we have, and we want to now build a gauge theory out of this. So, how you should need to teach these atoms that you should behave as a gauge theory. So the first thing that we need to do is, again, we need to take the continuum theory and put it on the lattice. I want to go into a little bit more detail here because it's important how we do it. So the different approaches, one that one can pursue is the Kolb-Susskind approach of staggered fermions. And there, sort of, does one take the fermion spinor and puts it on neighboring lattice sites. Okay? And then we have the electric field we put on the links between the sites, which makes sense because if the charge moves, then it picks up in the Harrow-Bohm phase that is given by the vector potential over the distance that it has moved. And so this would make sense to have the vector potential sitting on the link between two lattice sites. Good. And then so now the lattice Hamiltonian would look like this. We have the fermionic coupling here, coupled to the vector potential. We have the rest mass, and since we split the electrons and positrons, we have the staggering of minus one to the J, and we have the field energy. Now, the Gauss's law is just discretized. We have the divergence of electric field is now just the difference. We have the charge density here. So now the question is, okay, so how can we implement this in optical lattices? Well, here we have fermions. Okay, so these we can think about. Maybe we use the fermionic atoms. But what should we do with this, with the vector potential? And so one thing that one can use, and that is very widely used in this context, is the so-called quantum link model formalism. This actually has been reinvented three times or so under different names. But I think in this community, it's known under the name quantum link model formalism because Uwe Jens Wiese has introduced us to it and then propagated a lot. So if you're interested, you can look at this this review here. So what this formalism does, it essentially takes the electric field and replaces it by an SZ spin operator. So you can think about the field can go to minus, the plus infinity and minus infinity, and now we put cutoffs at plus and minus S. Yeah? But it's this cutoff is done in a clever way, namely that the relevant commutation relations are maintained and that the symmetries of the problem are maintained. So to do this, we replace U by an S plus operator. And then we get out this Hamiltonian here. So now we can think, oh wait, maybe that's a very crude approximation and so on, but it's much better than that. So it's actually, so first of all, it's still a U1 lattice gauge theory. It may look a little bit different than quantum electrodynamics, but it is still a U1 lattice gauge theory. And we can recover QED in well-defined limits. So this, if we send the spin length S to infinity, we get QED back. And we can also do something that is called dimensional reduction in certain situations to also to work with the quantum link model in one dimension higher, and then get QED in one dimension lower. Okay. Because the important thing is that this is a well-controlled thing, but now we have here an S plus spin that we need to realize. Okay? So now this is the model that we want. And so there are different ways now to try to put this in an optical lattice. One is to take this really literally and say, okay, we have here fermions and we have some spin, which has bosonic commutation relation maybe. So we need to somehow replace this by fermions and bosons. Okay. And so one way one can do this is in the following. One has a lattice where on the sides there sit the fermionic matter, and then on the links in between we put deep wells. So this is a very, very deep lattice where there are bosonic atoms that are localized to these wells. Okay? And now we use the Schwinger boson description to have these atoms represent a large spin. Okay, so essentially the imbalance between the up and down component gives us the SZ strength. So this would be a very strong field here. In this situation, as I've drawn this, if you map this back, we would map this to the Dirac vacuum for the matter fields. Okay, so here the positron sides are full, so the Dirac Z is filled, and the electrons are empty. Okay, so this would be something like the Dirac vacuum, and there are as a strong background field. Again, so this goes back to the remark as before. This is again the vacuum at the infinite mass, right, that I'm mentioning here. So we have the state preparation is very difficult if you want to talk about an extended state that is not at infinite mass. But it's also possible, but it's much more tricky. Essentially, it needs two stages of the experiment. So for simplicity, we start from this simple state here. Okay, and now the basic process would be now a scattering process where this fermion scatters off one of these bosons and it gets scattered to the other side, to another hyperfine state. And due to angular momentum conservation, this boson has to go to the other state. And then essentially what we have done is we have generated here a hole as compared to the previous configuration. So that's a positron. And we have an empty site here. So this is a fermion in this cartoon sketch. And then in accordance to that, one atom has gone to the other state, the imbalance has decreased, so the electric field has decreased. Okay, so this is the basic idea. This angular momentum conservation, this has been first proposed in this paper by Erde Soa, Nassifak, and Benny Resnick. And then there have been more and more works, especially in Heidelberg, where we have every time we have gotten rid of one experimental requirement. So I've neglected lots of experimental details here, yeah? But at each step we have essentially gotten rid of one requirement until in the end it was simple enough to be realized in an experiment. So for example, one thing that we realized, well, we can, in the simulator, we don't need to spatially separate these bosons here. We can put them on the same sides, and then we need to reformulate everything a little bit, but the same theory comes out just by relabeling stuff. But now both degrees of freedom can be locally together, which very much increases the scattering strength between them. So things like this. Huh? Okay, and this made it possible to realize this a single building block of that thing in the experiment by Fried and Yunus.
What is the meaning of angular momentum in one dimension?
So this is for the boson. So we need to look at the
But in one dimension, there is no angular momentum.
Well, okay. So allow me to say. So I mean, we have this hyperfine state of the atoms, and so it's the conservation of the effective spin of the atoms.
But it does not correspond to angular momentum, which requires at least two dimensions.
Yeah, okay, but I mean, I okay. Okay, but I mean, the spin space, so the one thing is the system that we want to simulate, which lives purely in 1D. But the atoms, they can be three-dimensional spin objects, right?
In other words, the internal structure of all these atoms is three-dimensional, of course.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. So the lattice that we have is
this is like one-dimension magnetic moments, where there are three-dimensional magnetic moments located at the lattice points in one dimension. Yeah, well, that's a very trivial explanation. It doesn't require such a long... I'm not an expert on quantum electrodynamics. I try to understand some physics.
Okay, yeah, so, I mean... okay, but it's, yes, I mean, these are exactly, and these are like little spins that sit on the, on these lattice sides. But I mean, these are three dimensional spins, right? So they sit just in a one dimensional lattice. So
this is. Yes.
Okay, but I mean, this angular momentum conservation is actually important because otherwise there can be a scattering process where this atom goes here, but then one of these so it remains up there and stuff like this. And so there are this, which would not be the processes that we want. Okay? So,
could one define this angular momentum in terms of the operators in the Hamiltonian?
If you say
conservation of angular momentum, that means that there is some operator that commutes mm-hmm. with the Hamiltonian.
Yes. So if you, it's a little bit tricky. You can map them to. Here because this Hamiltonian that I write up here, that's stripped of all the atomic physics details. Right. So of course this conservation it corresponds to the fact that actually. So if I look at this, here I'm only interested in the down state and the up state here. So I would have, for example, I could say that actually I have the conservation that on this side, a down atom scatters into an up atom. So I would need to put the labels here. And then correspondingly, there's a flip of up, down in there. And then I see that actually all these processes, they conserve angular momentum. But as it's written now, it's completely hidden because I've removed all these labels of the hyperfine states. But indeed, if I start, if one can look at, for example, one of these papers. No? So there, if you start from the atomic physics Hamiltonian, then we see there is the conservation law. Then we say, okay, which are processes that are only allowed, and then at the end we say, okay, now we throw away the labels that are not relevant anymore, and then we get this. This Hamiltonian order.
So when you reduce the problem to these two levels in each lattice site, mm-hmm. what quantity is conserved? Which quantity is conserved? Not that, angular momentum, it is...
That was my question. There must be an operator.
Yes, the difference between the occupation of different levels or what? Because now you reduce this angular momentum conservation to the two level system in each lattice site. So there is some correspondence between the angular momentum operator and the operator which commutes in this model, right?
Yes. So let's see if I understand.
Okay.
So yeah. So in this model here, so there are different implementations. So it's a little bit difficult to, because I neglected here to be able to draw it simpler, some additional things. For example, that actually this state here should be an energetic resonance to this. So there are two conservations, so to say. One is energy conservation, which makes it a little bit more difficult to disentangle these two, just staring at these equations here. Okay. But the hyperfine quantum number here, the MF state. Okay, the sum over MF is conserved here. Yeah? So this is one thing that enters, and then we have another thing that certain processes, are not allowed. So, for example, what I don't want, and these are energetically suppressed. Then, yeah? So I don't want that this scatters with one of these atoms and then comes into this side. Okay, and this, so they don't change their internal state, but they still have a scattering event. Okay, so this is something that I don't want, and this I get rid of, for example, by energetic suppression. It's just a very off-resonant process. And this is this satisfactory.
Philip, I suggest that you continue, okay?
Yeah, also in the interest of time. Okay. Okay. I just want to briefly give you a simpler realization of this model Hamiltonian here. Where instead of having, here we had really fermions and bosons, here instead we have now only bosonic degrees of freedom, but now we distinguish them, the meta side and the gauge links, by having two different lattices. So we have lattice side, sorry. We have a deep lattice side and a shallow lattice side. Okay, so now, and these two distinguish the things. This is the advantage that now we can use only bosons, which makes it experimentally much simpler. Of course, then one has to wonder how can we do it to two dimensions if you want fermions. Then this, one can do a similar setup, but it becomes more complicated. I don't want to go into much detail here because we don't have time. if you want, I can explain it. So essentially, this approach has the advantage that the lattice structure is now very, very simple. So it's just an optical superlattice, and we have a single atomic bosonic species, and we can generate the processes that we want just in second order perturbations. So they're very simple. But then the simplification comes at the price that we have a very coarse grained electric field. So we can have just two values, plus and minus 1/2. But this still gives us on one side it makes it now possible to look at a very large system. So now here we have, they did the experiment in the group of Zhang Wei Pan and Shen Zheng Wan in Heidelberg, where Bin Yang was the main postdoc, and so they did it in a very large system of 71 sites. Okay, so now we are really talking about scales that start to compete with the best numerics for out of equilibrium effects at least. And so they wanted to look at the Coleman phase transition. So what they did is they tuned the parameter rest mass from a very large negative value to a large positive and looked at the meta density and the electric field density. And then one sees that essentially we go, initially we have many charges. Okay, as we reduce the rest mass, we go through the quantum critical point, and then all these charges they annihilate each other. So we get a not completely empty but almost empty system, There are, of course, some defects because they don't go infinitely fast. And also there's a little bit of heating. So this region here, this DMRG calculations, and you see that there is some discrepancy. So it's not completely perfect, but actually, but still I would say very, very good. So there's some, a little bit of heating and probably higher band effects that we do not completely understand. But in any case, so what you see here is that already they can generate sizable domains of where the electric field just passes through the system. So this domain size is about what I've drawn here, which is comparable to experiments that they do in, when they want to generate antiferromagnets in cold atoms or something like this. Okay, so now I don't know how I'm doing with the time. You're muted there.
Sure, I see. So how much time do you need?
Well, as much.
As much. As you can give you now this.
No, I can go fast.
Okay. Is 10 minutes? 5-10 minutes is enough?
Yeah, that's it.
Okay.
Good. I want to summarize this. So to see where the field is at. Huh? We have these two approaches. Okay, the one where we use the try to use the degrees of freedom as efficiently as possible by using actually the Gauss law to get rid of one of the degrees of freedom that we don't need. The interactions, as I've shown you, can be quite complicated, and then there can also be strange things such as if you have a spin flip, for example, then because we've integrated out the electric field, we would now interpret this spin as a fermion plus all the electric field. So if you have a spin flip error, then this means that this corresponds to an error where a charge pops out of the vacuum and then it's out of nothing. And then there's an electric field string to it attached that comes from minus infinity, which I'm not sure how to interpret such an error. Okay, on the other side, we have these things seen about where we keep 2 degrees of freedom. It's not as efficient in the use of degrees of freedom, but it has the advantage that now we can test how gauge invariance emerges. So we can test what do violations of gauge invariance do. It's a new question that we can ask. And this tells us also something about questions, hopefully, how in nature could gauge invariance emerge. So do we need to postulate it as a law of nature, or can it emerge in an effective system like this? The disadvantage is that we need to make sure somehow by some means that the gauge symmetry is realized. And as I've shown you, that in both of these approaches, we have now dozens of qubits reachable. So if you start looking at out of equilibrium dynamics, for example, tensor networks can do they can do dozens of qubits. They can do maybe 100, but they cannot go to very, very long times. So we are there. We can now start really to compete, and maybe in a couple of years there could be quantum simulations that overcome the classical classical calculations. Right now we are not there yet, for sure. And then it comes, of course, the other question: how can we prove that the quantum simulator has actually a quantum advantage, and so on, which is also very, very important and open question, I think. Okay, so I will just very briefly this last question about the reliability of quantum simulators. This is something that actually I started wondering about back when I was with Maciek already 10 years ago or so. But recently we have done some progress. I'm just going to give a little bit of some teasers of what's happening. One big question here is, if I show you such a plot and maybe one can believe there's a quantum phase transition, okay, one can always ask, is this really a gauge theory? I mean, there are many interesting models that have quantum phase transitions, so where do you see really this is a gauge theory? And we were also wondering this. So these guys in the lab, they went down and measured that they have only allowed configurations, which in this mapping would correspond to these three configurations of atoms in the optical lattice. So what they did is they really measured that they have only these three configurations, but for them, it's okay, a quantum gas microscope, maybe you can do a snapshot and then just count the atoms and you can see if the system fulfills Gauss's law or not, but they don't have a quantum gas microscope. So instead, they needed to combine 10 different measurements of having, for example, two particles here or one there, and things that are not allowed. They measured many, many different things, yeah? Combined these measurements, and then got the number out that gives an upper bound on the gauge violation. So then they plotted this as a function of the sweep, and they see that it's on a quite low level. So this is a log scan here. So indeed, it never goes above 0.1 or so. So this is the first time that the quantum simulator has actually certified how well Gauss's law is achieved. So that's, I think that's very, very nice. But of course, now we can still play devil's advocate and say, okay, good, you have certified it, but still Gauss's law is violated. So still, is this a gauge theory or not? And that's a question that we are working on since a year or so, a bit longer, very, very intensively. So we have, for example, we have this whole series of works that just study this question, what do violations of gauge symmetry do? One that I find very nice in this context is we did some ground state calculations with the MPS, which was done in the group by Martin van Damme, that is in the group of Frank Verstraete. And so we see that as we increase the strength of the gauge violation, there is a transition here. So the Coleman's phase transition remains intact until a certain point, and then we extract that there is actually a phase transition from still a renormalized gauge theory to what I could call a Higgs phase, so where we lose the gauge symmetry. Okay? So that's quite reassuring, because even if you have a small violation, if you're down here, we still see the right physics. We're also wondering what we can do to controllably improve gauge symmetry. And one thing that one does in the community is to add an energy penalty in some form. And we found that rigorously that you can actually add an energy penalty that is just linear. I don't know if you can actually see what is this stuff here. An energy penalty that is just linear in the Gauss law. So these are just single body terms. And then we did lots of different numerics with exact diagonalization, MPS, and so on. To see what happens, and we see that okay, with this you can really controllably suppress any violations on very, very small degrees to essentially infinitize with calculations to 10 to the 40. Okay, and this is a final remark, which I also find quite exciting. In a more general context, we were wondering about trotter errors together with Markus Heil and the group of Peter Zoller, and there we saw that there's actually as a function of the trotter step size also sort of a transition in the dynamics between a controlled regime where the trotter steps just enters as a perturbative parameter, and then there's a chaotic regime where just things give completely random results. Okay, so it's also, I think, quite exciting because there are, of course, rigorous bounds on trotter errors, but they are very strict, mathematical, rigorous bounds that are, so to say, in the worst case scenario, the worst thing that can happen to your quantum computer. But this means that all the phases of the unitary time evolution operator, all of them need to be perfect, which is, of course, if you talk about physical effects, it's maybe not what you want, because you have to look at some average quantities, local observables, and so on, and there it's much more benign. So here we see that actually this controlled regime we get for the trotter step size of one, even for very long, and it stays there for essentially infinite times. Very also makes very optimistic that even if you do a trotterized evolution, you can do controlled results for large systems and long times. Okay, so these are just some pieces. So now I need to conclude. So I wanted to give you an idea of how can we push forward also in this more general context. I think here, if you think about, if you broaden it up, then you can think about gauge theories really as a valuable target for this quantum simulation, quantum computation, because of all this fascinating physics and because we can test our implementation and error mitigation strategies. And so what I've shown you, our recent progress in the field is to get really scalable implementations where we have now orders of magnitude larger systems than just a few years ago. Well, one order of magnitude. We've seen that there are lots of interesting phenomena here, the Coleman's phase transition trigger mechanism, these new types of topological transitions in the dynamics, strange staircase parameterization, There's also disorder-free localization, lots of interesting things to investigate, even in the near term, in simplified models. We've also made some progress in understanding what errors do in these systems. And now what we need to do next is really to increase the complexity. There are very few works that study two-dimensional systems or non-abelian in this context. And these are essentially one or two plaquettes or something like this, so very, very small systems. And so we need to find ways to also have these more complex situations in a scalable way. And so again, I'm ready to look at the reviews. What I'm trying to show you is that there has been, in the last few years, very exciting progress, but there's still lots of things to be done. So finally, I just want to thank the team. So we have lots of outside collaborators, which also shows that it's really a community effort. There's many people with different expertise come together. In my group, this is especially Jean Talimé, who's the postdoc, who's pushing this forward, and the two PhD students, Haifeng Lang and Julius Miltenberger, who are working on implementations and questions of reliability. And yeah, with this, I thank you.
Okay, thank you, Philip, for a nice talk. So we are a bit over time, but maybe someone would like to ask a question.
I have a small remark, if I may. Okay. Okay. I think it should be pointed out that that 1D QED is not a theory of point particles restricted to a line, but it's a theory of infinite planes.
So can you repeat the theory of infinite?
Yeah. That 1D QED is not a theory of electrons and positrons for which point particles that for which motion is restricted to a line. It's rather the theory of infinite planes, charged planes.
Yes, because roughly speaking, in order to get one-dimensional theory from electrodynamics, or suppose that the other two dimensions are irrelevant. Moreover, I have a more general remark, which is closely related to those issues which were mentioned by Professor Białynicki and Turski, that one means is a phenomenological theory, but it has two great advantages. First of all, it does exist in nature, and then it is mathematically well defined. Whereas, if you such fundamental theories like electrodynamics or chromodynamics, which are roughly speaking based on wave equations, have completely different behavior in different dimensions. Therefore, I am not sure whether we may. Wave equation in two dimensions has nothing to do with wave equations in four dimensions. These are completely different theories. Okay, you may think about those planes mentioned by Kajik, of course. But then what are those planes?
Can I come to this? So I guess I agree that in the sense that, the physics, of course, changes completely. Right? If you go to higher dimensions, also non-abelian theories, there's completely different physics. But here...
flow is completely different. Here, static field is just constant between charges.
Effort of putting a gauge theory on some sort of discretized system, or that's very interesting, I think.
Of course.
Exactly.
Maybe, of course. This is a discretized system which is different than the usual conceptual lattice, right?
So you yes.
envision just point in space-time or Euclidean space separated by a distance r on a square cubic lattice. So I think that's very interesting. I with a lot of joy, I see also a lot of experience popping out from things which I associate with quantum optics. Mm-hmm. All these magic transformations where sigma z appears as a representation of operators. And it's very clear that Maciek Levenstein had an experience in quantum optics. Yeah, and I think everybody is going to profit from that.
Sure.
Exactly. I agree. So let me just for this about the physics. I mean, this is so the one side is more or less you mentioned. So what we want to do here is we want to put these theories on a lattice. And so what we do is we take the most simple theory that is still interesting that you can put on a lattice and try to see how far we can get. We try to see how can we get errors under control. What are good implementation strategies that actually in the end will work? So I agree that this. So yes, I mean what we are doing here is we are not solving maybe real world problems right now, right? But the idea is, and maybe I hope in some future we will do. Yeah. But we want to test all these strategies, and then if you go to a three spatial dimension lattice, and then maybe have even non-abelian theory on. I mean, then we see completely different physics. So I agree. But I think the implementation strategies, we need to start to develop them somewhere. And so for this, we need to take simpler models. And even if the physics is of course different, we still need to start somewhere. We cannot go for the full-blown thing right away. So that's somehow the spirit here.
Can I make a small physical comment? There was this discussion that in one dimension, this system you discuss corresponds to the charge plates. But in the real physics, we do have a lots of one-dimension charge particle systems where the only difference is that the interaction between the charges in one-dimensional real physical system is a simple Coulomb one-dimensional interaction, which has a dielectric constant which comes out from the remaining two dimensions. So there are one-dimensional charge systems, not necessarily plates, but then the interaction is of is a Coulomb interaction, and it's not infinite dimension because there is a screening effect. And I wonder how much of the problems in your analysis comes out from the fact that this quasi-Coulomb interaction you introduce is infinite range.
Yes, it does. Some of the problems come out of this. Yeah. So if I had a Coulomb interaction that decreases with distance, so if I have the 1 over r interactions, then it's much more natural for the trapped ion quantum computer. And then I could start thinking about some analog implementation. And they don't really interact with 1 over r, it's some power law that one can tune, but one can try to get something that is close to 1 over r, and then it needs just a little bit massaging that it reproduces this law. Yeah? So indeed, that would make things easier.
No? I have a feeling that maybe I am wrong, that even much less lattice points, but organized in the real three-dimensional lattice would give more insight into the physical behavior of the real physical system.
Maybe, but it could be. Yeah? I mean, at least, so I think, so for sure we're going to try this now, to go to higher dimensions, because, but you also need to see that just in the last few years, we had 2016, these were 4 qubits. No? And then of course we cannot talk about going to higher dimensions. I mean, it's even questionable if this is even a 1D system. No? But now, I mean, this is one thing. So we now have achieved that we have quite large systems in in one dimension. So exactly, yeah. So, I mean, this is the next natural step, to try to do smaller systems, but try to increase the dimension. So probably the next step that we're going to do is in two dimensions, because that, just the structure is much simpler experimentally if you have to control just a plane.
Potentially there could be also one extra difficulty. I mean, Schwinger model is in a sense constrained because, as you mentioned, you can integrate out gauge degrees of freedom, and that trick doesn't work in higher dimensions. So some of difficulties, even numerical difficulties you may encounter, can be related to the fact that somehow you have this additional constraint, and the effort to, as that disappears in higher dimensions, the effort to cope with them maybe just not, I mean, to some extent irrelevant, right? Because you have very strongly constrained system. It is analytically solvable in some cases. And it is very often that if you have analytical solution and try to reproduce it correctly in numerical calculation, then you can of course fight with some more or less small errors for a very long time.
So this is also, these are there were several things in this remark. Let's see. So first, I mean, there are practical difficulties. I mean, yes, so this integrating out, as I showed it, this will not work in higher dimensions. But this, the trick that they used for the Rydberg atoms, that should also work. So the Rydberg atoms, they did it in some other way. And that should also work in two dimensions. Then I don't remember the details. They need several Rydberg states locally, which need to interact in a very specific manner with each other, which is also not very simple. So you have this strange interaction pattern, but it's all local and it can be in principle extended to higher dimensions. Yes, but also in higher dimensions, there are also known issues from the lattice community that people there know for a long time. Know that if you talk about fermions in higher dimensions, and we need to be very careful how we discretize it, and there are these problems, the fermionic tastes and all these things. So these are also needs to be very, very careful how one even puts the system on the lattice. And the stability, exactly, that's also an important point which needs more thought, because so I mean it's not clear. So one thing, so now we understand that the models that we've been looking at, they are very benign in terms of breaking of gauge invariance. We have these controlled regimes where the physics remains completely intact, and we can really on a controlled level have the gauge invariance, but we can renormalize it away that we still have a gauge theory and so on. So now I'm not completely sure how this extends to higher dimensions. I think there are results in the literature that one needs to that one can check. But there are also, I mean, there are lots of subtleties that come in. That's also true.
Okay, I think we should conclude. No, we should. Well, let's thank Philippe again for the nice talk. Let's thank everyone for.
Okay. Thanks a lot for all the questions.
And let me thank everyone for joining in today's colloquium.